Hi everyone, I'm Emily. If you're not familiar with who I have been making art content here on YouTube for the past 6 years. For the majority of those 6 years and several years prior, I had been facing stalking, harassment, and threats from one very recognizable source. For many years, I had no idea who this person was. I had speculations, but they were pretty far off. And because of that, I had to endure that abuse. I went to the police, I was turned away. I spoke to an attorney, they told me it's not going to be worth it taking it to court. I even went as far as hiring a private investigator for a short period of time, and he said the same thing. The PI and the attorney advised me that I needed to start taking screenshots of everything that I could and keeping track of what was happening to me. This story is long, so I recommend you watch it at 1.5 speed if you can. It's long because this stalking campaign has lasted the better part of a decade. And while I didn't know who my stalker was before, now I know who my stalker is. My stalker is Shannon, better known as CreepShow Art, and what I believe to be her current husband, Anthony Parker, who is also my abusive ex-partner. This has been my life. This has been the thing that has terrified me, that has kept me up at night. It was incredibly difficult, but also incredibly cathartic. And Shannon, Anthony, if you're watching this, you have no idea what you guys have done to me. You think it's funny. You think it's something you can laugh about behind the scenes. You think it's retribution because I was a drug addict. You have made my life so much more difficult than it ever needed to be, when I was in an incredibly vulnerable place. And what you have done is sick and twisted and cruel. And I hope that you never have the chance to do that to anyone else ever again. When I went into recovery for the final time, I did the work, I worked hard, and I had to take a long, hard look at myself in the mirror. And it wasn't pretty. It was ugly and it was broken, but I had to do it in order to change. Shannon, you need help. And this is me and everyone else asking you to go get help. Not just for yourself, but for the people that you have hurt. You need to take that long, hard look in the mirror like I did and see the ugly, broken pieces. There's no magic glue to put every single piece back together perfectly, but once it's all put back together, there is a clearer reflection. I have to say, for legal purposes, that everything in this video is alleged. I just encourage people to look at the evidence and form their own opinions. I also want to say I originally censored Anthony's name in this video. I called him Andrew, just kind of out of a habit. But I decided I'm not going to do that anymore. His handle online is Anthony Parker, and he raped me and he emotionally abused me and manipulated me when I was most vulnerable. And for the better part of the decade, he tried to make my life a living hell. Thank you everyone, and here's the video. Hey guys, so today I'm going to be discussing something I never thought I would get a chance to discuss publicly. If you're not sure what this is in reference to, I will link a few videos down below for people better explaining what has gone on. This is in reference to CreepShow Art, or Shannon, as most people know her, and actually my ex boyfriend, believe it or not, who we will call Andrew. I've kind of had to get to a place where I turn off my emotions in order to just get through this quickly and concisely. I will warn you, I do not have all the receipts for everything. I have a very good handful of receipts pretty much proving that the person who has been stalking, harassing, and threatening me has been Shannon and my ex-boyfriend, Andrew. Now, people are saying she is a husband. I guess I do not know if she went on to marry Andrew. I did not keep up with them just because they had traumatized me so much that by the time I figured out the person who had been stalking me for the better part of a decade was Shannon. I just blocked everything. I didn't want to see her. I didn't want to hear her. I didn't even want to know she existed. I kept it all inside. I blocked her. I blocked him. I wanted nothing to do with them. So I don't know. I don't know. I haven't watched most of her videos, except ones that are relevant to this, I guess, situation. This is going to be a long story, and it starts in a kind of weird, kind of irrelevant place, and it requires you to know a little bit about me, so I'm just going to try to get through that as quickly as possible. In case you don't know me, hi, my name is Emily. I make art content here on YouTube. I've been doing it for about 6 years now.
something that's important that doesn't seem like it's would be at all important, but it is. I'm very open. I have struggled with addiction since I was about 14 years old. I am 7 years sober, I guess. I don't have an official sober birthday anymore because there were a few instances of relapse back then. So I just kind of go with 7, 6 years sober somewhere in there. I also struggled with an eating disorder and some pretty serious mental health issues. I feel like I have a pretty good hold on those things right now, especially my addiction. It feels so far away from me. I feel like I've come very far and I've done a lot of work on myself. That is the number one thing I advocate on my channel is reflect, 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 and you know, learn to acknowledge and own up to your mistakes. There have been several times on this channel that my own viewers have had to call me out and say, hey, this is shitty. And I've had to really take a good hard look at myself and kind of move forward and do better and work things out in therapy. And, you know, I think that's really important. And that's kind of what my whole YouTube channel is built around. You know, do art, do what you love, fuck the rest, but also, you know, have the ability to change and grow and be introspective. So I'm going to try to start from the beginning. The beginning timeline is a little bit hazy just because, you know, drugs. So I was somewhere between 18 and 20, I want to say. I was a gig musician making shit all doing that because I still lived at home and I was a student. I took a gig performing at Nickel City Arcade in San Jose because they used to allow the shittiest of bands to perform in their literal birthday room. And Andrew was there with some friends. We ended up hitting it off and we entered into a very toxic codependent relationship. I was on a lot of psych meds and I was also abusing certain prescription medications, specifically sleeping medications. There were several points in the relationship where I had like a full-on mental breakdown from all the cocktail of drugs going on in my system. And I basically expressed that I am deeply unhappy. I don't know if this relationship is a good thing or a bad thing. I'm very vulnerable. And every time that would happen, we would cry, we would hug, and we would go right back to that codependent relationship. It was a short-lived relationship, but it was very memorable because of how often I was afraid of Andrew and deeply concerned about what he might do, not just to me, but to other people. He would often punch holes in the drywall of his home, and him and his friend Brandon would go into great detail about donning black trench coats like the Columbine killers, going into their old high school and shooting it up. They were very much of the belief that they were the intellectuals in their high school, and like all the footballers and the cheerleaders hated them, so F those people. They were very of that belief and kind of that, unfortunately, that stereotype. I think they acted with an air of superiority, but at the same time, they were incredibly self-deprecating, often calling themselves the F-A-G-S slur. It was a very confusing dynamic, a very confusing relationship that the two of them had. It was definitely concerning. I also came to find out years later that Andrew was regularly flirting and essentially cheating on me, exchanging photographs with other women. Which is really funny because the reason we broke up is because I commented on my very openly gay friend's, I think, Facebook picture like, ooh, you look hot today, double winky face. And that caused Andrew, I guess, to go into a rage. And so he had his best friend Brandon call me a slut and threaten to curb stomp me, to hurt me, and just repeating, I hope you're happy. I hope you're happy. You hope you can never live with yourself again. You are so filthy. And just berated me, just completely and utterly berated and shamed me and made me feel like a piece of shit. I cried. I was upset. I couldn't get a hold of Andrew after that. So the next day, I drove to his work. Now, Shannon worked where Andrew worked. I had seen Shannon on several occasions, never spoke to her, just kind of would wave to her, never spent time with her. I just knew of her. I drove to Andrew's work, to see if I could speak to him after his shift. He did not come into work that day. I went home. I cried about it. I believe I sent him one last, like, what the fuck message. And then time went on. Everybody moved on. It was fine. Didn't reach out again. Andrew actually reached back out to me down the road, basically saying, hey, sorry for how things ended. We should be friends now. Then, of course, as all codependent relationships do, we entered into this kind of weird middle ground flirtationship that became unhealthy. So I decided to kind of end it, kind of step back away from that. Then he expressed interest in having a professional relationship, having me sing on one of his tracks. The stupid feeling that I know you know, I know we know I can't. You run away, close your eyes, blame yourself, count to five, will I ever see you? I never seem to wonder why I ever wondered if all I needed was a hope. See through the eyes of an aeronaut, all the fiction you knew to trust, a telltale component of shy stardust. He sent me an MP3, and I noticed there was already a girl singing on the track. Now, let me be clear and honest right here, right now. I went through a hashtag pick me, hashtag anti-feminist phase. I 100% did. And I was about to say, I don't know how, why, like, that happened. I do know why that happened. I was not only in a very vulnerable place, I was using drugs, my brain was all sorts of just not functioning on a proper level, but besides Andrew, I had another domineering, powerful, abusive man in my life that was taking advantage of me in ways that I do not feel comfortable talking about publicly. So I had no control. I had no bodily autonomy. I had no control. I had no control. I had nothing. So you know how I took control back? I learned this in therapy, by being a fucking bitch. That's how I took it back. And I never got to anywhere near Shannon levels of conniving bitchery. It was very open out front, like lots of like hashtag anti-feminist and oh, feminist, roll eye, like just the stereotypical pick me girl. I was 100% that. I believe it through and through. Now, most of my ire was aimed towards celebrities. Like I wanted to get people riled up, like about their favorite celebrities. So I would shit on celebrities and say really fucked up things. Like I'd slut shame them. I was super fat phobic. I was not a good person. That's not a different person, by the way. I don't like when people say, well, I'm not that person. I was that person. That person evolved. That person reflected. And that person had to change, especially when I got sober. I really, really feel like my eyes started to open up as my brain repaired itself. He sent me the track. I hear the girl's voice. The girl's voice is Shannon's. And I say, man, that girl's voice is weak. It doesn't sound good on the track. My voice would sound so much better. Super catty, super bitchy, and super insecure, immature. There's a million words I could use for what I said about it. So I put Shannon down to raise myself up. And I believe in doing that, that is what set off this chain of events, the stalking, the harassment, the threats. So I made that comment. Andrew didn't really react to it too much. I think he just said, like, wow, you think you're so confident. Like, it was a slightly negative reaction, but he still had me come in and sing on the track. What was interesting is when I started working professionally with him is when I started noticing some, like, really negative comments across all my social media. And at this point, the Emily Artful channel wasn't a thing yet. I just had, like, random social media accounts. I think I had a Minecraft account, an anime. I did short films. I had, like, a separate art account that was unrelated, a music account. And I started noticing a lot of really negative comments. I didn't think much of it because that's just kind of, you know, the business on social media is you get negative comments. I figured it was normal. I was just seeing an increased volume in them. Something else I noticed kind of retroactively was that I was receiving a lot of Facebook friend requests from people that I didn't know, but I would have like a handful of mutual friends with. So I would, of course, accept these requests. And these were coming from Andrew and I believe Shannon, because this is Shannon for Shannon. Andrew is, you know, Andrew could be anyone. I have to say allegedly for Shannon to protect myself legally, because even though there is, I feel like, a lot of proof pointing in that direction, obviously nobody could say at any point, you know, when did Shannon potentially partake in any of this? You know, who knows? So I want to make sure I put that little disclaimer in right here. Who knows? But I believe at this point, potentially, Shannon was working with Andrew to try to get up as much information about me as possible. Now, they ended up phishing me and locking me out of that original Facebook account. Now, I had had that original Facebook account since I was a minor, since Facebook came out. And hidden in the messages of that account were some compromising photographs. Now, most of them were of me as an adult, but unfortunately, there were a few of me as a minor. And I tried to express that to my stalker several times, but they just disregarded it and said that I was a liar, which was infuriating and deeply upsetting and traumatizing. And what did they do with these photographs? Well, they went ahead and put them into a photo bucket account, as well as some other photographs from a website that I was on. At this point, I was doing some webcamming, not exactly something that I was doing of my own free will. A lot of that wasn't, but that's not Andrew and Shannon's fault. But they compiled a bunch of photographs, inappropriate photographs of me in this photo bucket account, and just taunted me with them, locked me out of my account. And then they emailed me with the email that they had managed to switch out my email for on the Facebook account. And the email, if I remember correctly, was, why do I have to do this 22 at Gmail, or 44? It was a double number. And the email that they sent me was pretty much of that tone. Why do I have to do this? I don't know, but I have to do this. Sorry. And then they blocked my email so I could not respond. And at the time, it was like impossible to get your Facebook account back. It was impossible because the like very stereotypical hackings had not happened yet. I have since still tried to recover that Facebook account, but I have had no luck. They went in and changed the phone number, the recovery phone number, the email. They changed everything. So I eventually actually became scared of trying to gain access to that account, because I was afraid that I would irritate my stalker and they would, you know, dangle those photographs, some of which in which I was a minor, over my head. Again, I'm going to repeat, I have no idea if at this point Shannon was involved or not, but it was incredibly traumatic and upsetting. Again, I'm just trying to keep my brain devoid of emotion. That is pretty much how I've had to deal with this situation, these events, the entire time that they've been happening. And this is going on over the course of several years. Something else that happened is a lot of body shaming. Andrew knew that I had struggled and continue to struggle to this day, even with an eating disorder. And I think he wanted to get a rise out of me, and he wanted to have me relapse, essentially. So a lot of body shaming. I have been overweight and I have been severely underweight. I have been on both sides of the spectrum. So I know the pain coming from both angles. So there was lots of body shaming my face. People are commenting that I guess Shannon had made a lot of transphobic comments. Let me just say right now, the number one insult, this is how I know it's her, across the board, because, you know, everybody is haters, but I know it's her when I'm called pre-op or TRANNY slur, or when did you get your operation and do you still have, you know, boy parts down there. Just lots of incredibly transphobic insults. At this point in my life, I was not doing well. I was not in a good way. I was deep into a drug addiction that I was just floundering. My eating disorder was all over the place, and I was still in a very, very toxic, not romantic relationship, but a business relationship with someone where I had no bodily autonomy. So just I was in a very, very horrible, bad way. And I didn't really have control of much. I tried to get a regular job. And Andrew and potentially Shannon found out about this regular job and decided to email my job and send them a compromising video of myself. They posed as a client, said, "I'm a regular client. You've lost my business because look at your, you know, disgusting human being of a receptionist." Now, I am going to try and get in touch with this job to confirm that they did fire me because they received this email. Looks like they've had a change in business name, but I think that that will be a very important receipt. So I'm really going to try hard to get that. But yeah, when I finally had some sense of normalcy and I felt like I was able to be free and maybe potentially break free of this really toxic cycle that I was in, they got me fired from my fucking job. And I actually ended up homeless for a period of time. So anytime Shannon talks about being homeless and having to live in her car, she did that to me. Allegedly. Hi, future Emily here. So Shannon was never technically quote unquote homeless. I mean, she was without a home, but in the traditional sense, her and Anthony were homeless by choice. And I know that because listen to what Anthony says in this video he posted on his YouTube channel in August of last year.
So in this video, I wanted to go over what it was like to be homeless or kind of partially be homeless, living out of a car for about 2.5-3 years or so. And keep in mind, this was a conscious decision to do this. We didn't get evicted and thrown out on the street or something like that. We planned for this for about 6 months to about a year or so. And I also thought it would be kind of fun to go over the recording rig that I had kept while we were living out of the car and how I managed timing and working on headphones and a computer in the public library just during their operating hours. Around 2015 or so, a few friends and I decided that it was a good idea to try and save rent money by moving into our cars, essentially. We weren't too happy living in California, and the rent is atrociously high, and it's just getting higher. The culture there is kind of pathetic. I mean, because what's weird about San Jose specifically, and a lot of the southern parts of Silicon Valley, there's not really a dominant culture there. It's especially amongst millennials. It's a lot of, I've always described it as different subsets of millennials LARPing and trying to turn Campbell and South San Jose into something that it's not. And more specifically, I would meet, I don't know, an actor or something like that who wants to pretend that it's LA, or I'd meet a pretentious goth girl who wants to act like it's San Francisco and is kind of pissed off that it's not really San Francisco. And I'd meet these redneck kind of characters that want to pretend that it's Alabama or something like that. And I'm like, well, you grew up like 5 blocks away from me. Like, it's not.
And to be fair, I don't know if Shannon has ever clarified that they were homeless by choice. But from what I'm reading, it seems like anytime she got called out, she would use her homelessness and the hardships she went through while being homeless as kind of like an excuse for her behavior. So I don't know if she ever clarified that it was by choice. Basically, hashtag van life. Anytime I had control of my life in any way, they would try desperately to take it away from me. I have tried to turn my emotions off this whole time, but I can't hear. They wanted me destroyed. Any good thing that I could have, they wanted it destroyed. And anytime I saw that light, they would snuff out that light so fucking fast. And that is not even the worst of it. I'm going to compose myself and come back. So after this happened, I went into a really dark downward spiral. There was a lot that was very difficult for me. that I had to overcome pretty much completely on my own. But then once I did overcome it, I ended up meeting someone, moving in with them and getting a different job. And again, you know, Andrew and potentially maybe Shannon did everything they could to try to find out where I was working. For some reason, they knew it was at a restaurant, a specific type of restaurant. So they literally, like, copied exactly one of my friend's Facebook accounts, took the about information, all of their pictures, and made this other Facebook account and acted like, oop, my Facebook got deleted, Emily. Like, can you add me again? And my dumbass was like, okay. And so, oh my God, I want to scream at my past self. But I accepted the friend request. And then, of course, they post, hey, does anybody know of any really cool, this specific type of cuisine restaurants in this specific location? And at that point, I'm like, you are not my friend. And so I blocked them. I knew right away that they were trying to find out where I worked. They wanted to try to bait me to be like, yeah, I work here, so that they could call and get me fired from another job. But I was like, no, F you. Block them, let my other friend know, hey, you're being impersonated. And so I believe that account got taken down very quickly because he reported that account as an impersonation account. At this point, I was starting to do better. I was starting to experience sobriety. I was on a program. Things were looking up. And I started the Emily Artful channel. And I decided going forward, I had done a lot of therapy and healing. I was not so much of a hashtag pick me anymore. I was learning a lot about myself and my flaws and what I needed to do better. And I put a lot of that love and energy and time into the Emily Artful channel. I still put my heart and that same kind of love into the Emily Artful channel. I know it's been inconsistent lately. I've been dealing with so much after my last baby was born, just so much. And this channel, I know some people, it's like it's a business, and I do see it as a business, but at the core, this channel saved me. This channel kept me back on track. You guys, this little community that we've built, I really feel like this channel saved me. It continues to save me. Sorry for the sappy moment. This is difficult. So that's when I noticed the comments started appearing again. And at that point, I was fully aware that I had a stalker, that someone was harassing me. And at that point, it was terrifying because I had no idea who it was. Because there had been a handful of toxic people in my life. When you do drugs and your mind is not functioning in the way that it needs to be, and also when your brain is in recovery as well, unfortunately, you tend to gravitate towards those codependent relationships. And I was certainly one of those people. I started my series Sketchbook Storytime because I noticed there was kind of like a gap in the market. There were storytime channels and there were art channels, and obviously there were millions of gaming channels at the time, but I'd not seen thus far anyone marry art and story times. Do I think I'm like the absolute 100% first person who's ever done this ever? No, but I did try pretty hard to find other people doing sketchbook story times, but I couldn't find that. So I came up with this term and I created the series where I talked about different incidents in my life. And then I started getting these comments, people saying like, do you know CreepShow Art? And CreepShow Art is copying you. And have you seen this CreepShow Art girl? I was getting comments that were like, interesting. They were like, ugh, you're just a ripoff of CreepShow Art. And then opposite comments that were like, love you, Emily. CreepShow Art is a ripoff of you. Like, what was interesting is I was getting a lot of these comments about this one YouTuber and nobody else. Even though I've done like challenges and trends, and I didn't feel you know, I feel like art YouTubers, we all kind of like borrow ideas from each other. So it's like I was never compared to anyone else but CreepShow art. Now, I thought it was kind of weird, but I was also new to the environment. So I figured it was probably like it came with the territory, essentially. So I didn't think anything of it until I got a comment of someone saying, hey, CreepShow art has stolen a few of your thumbnails as well as your sketchbook story time name. Like she has completely ripped off your series. And so then my ears pricked up a little bit and I did notice some of the thumbnails were slightly similar, but I did see that she was using my sketchbook story time like name for her series. And I was like, eh. But I watched a couple of her videos and honestly, like, I liked the videos. I thought she was personable and enjoyable. Now, at that point, I had been doing YouTube maybe for two or three years, I want to say. So I had been around for quite some time before her. Excuse me, before her. But I wasn't like this much larger channel. I was still quite a small channel. So when I approached her and I sent her a private message, I was perfectly polite. I didn't want to feel like I was like coming in here and trying to intimidate her to get her to change her series name. Hi, Shannon. My name is Emily, and I have a channel on YouTube called Emily Artful. It's been brought to my attention that you have a series with the exact same name as a series I created 3 years ago called Sketchbook Storytime. I'm going to guess this was most likely 100% by accidents or by coincidence, but I put my heart and soul into my series, and I'd really, really appreciate if you were able to change the name of your storytime videos. You are completely within your right not to, as it's your channel, and you can do with it as you please, but from one artist to another, I hope you'll understand how it can hurt my business. I love your art, and it's obvious you're very talented. You've got an incredibly unique style. I've never seen anything like it. I hope you understand my requests, and I hope you don't think I'm angry. Things like this happen all the time. I figure it's just a coincidence. Thank you, Emily. And Shannon responded, sorry, man, I watched Lehman Raptor on YouTube, and she has a series titled the same name, and she gave me a go-ahead. I'll just label them as story time, since that's all it is, but I appreciate you letting me know your concern. Looking into it, there are quite a few accounts using the same name for similar series, kind of like Get Ready For Me for beauty YouTubers almost. I think at the very least you might have started a trend, which is commendable. Sorry I made you uncomfortable in any way, my dude. By the way, I tried to find at that time other people calling their things sketchbook story time, and I actually couldn't find that. And maybe I just wasn't looking hard enough, or maybe Lehman Raptor, who she mentioned, like had changed the name. I don't know if she got wind of it, or I don't even know, but I couldn't find anyone else calling their like story times, sketchbook story times. And now there's tons of people calling them sketchbook story times because, as I say here in a minute on the receipt, it's a pretty generic name. Like now I would never in a million years. But at the time, I was still kind of green. I was getting to know the layout of the land. And again, it's like a generic name. So whatever. I'm totally actually, if anything, supportive now of people using sketchbook story time because that is what it is. But regardless, I was very polite and friendly. So I wasn't bullying anyone. I wasn't trying to be intimidating. And she responded in kind. And then I said, thank you so much. And no, didn't make me uncomfortable one bit. I was pretty sure it was just a coincidence. I'm so glad I was able to start a trend within the community. I just want to protect certain properties that I've started. The act of storytelling itself is wonderful, and I hope more and more people keep sharing. Maybe I shouldn't have picked such a generic name. And again, I repeat, now I totally get. Like, please, everyone use sketchbook story time. Do not feel the need to ask me. But I was very green at the time, you know, fresh off of those DeviantArt presses. Like, that's what I remembered is protect your OCs, protect your properties, you know, to protect your intellectual properties. I'd already had something stolen of mine at one point. So after that was settled, I received a DM with a screenshot of my YouTube homepage, including my icon. And in my icon, there's me, Emily, with long black hair. And I was wearing a winter scarf around my neck. But since it was also black, everything kind of blended together. And this sock puppet account said, your new icon looks like you're wearing a hijab, just so you know. I know you're not Muslim, so I wanted to make sure no one got offended. And I was like, yeah, you know, it might be wise for me to change that. Then later on, the sock puppet account messages me again and says, I just found another channel that is copying you. Have you heard of Creepshow Art? And I say, yeah, people have been messaging me a lot lately and saying she is copying me. I just think she's got a very similar personality type to me. We had a discussion about her calling her new series Sketchbook Storytime, and she very kindly said she'd change it. Otherwise, I don't really have much of an issue with what she does as long as it's not a close to exact ripoff of my content. And this sock puppet account continues to kind of push and egg on. I think it's super similar, ... Have you seen any of them? Just really trying to get a reaction out of me there. And I say, I have. I agree, they are very similar. But again, I'm not worried about it. As long as he doesn't directly copy anything from me, it should be fine. And then the sock puppet says, you have a really good attitude about it, smiley. I'm glad you aren't angry. And I know that right there, allegedly, that was Shannon allegedly being upset that I did not have a reaction or said something crappy behind her back because, you know, I'm not her. And see, after our previous conversation, when I actually talked to the quote-unquote real Shannon, I had added her on Instagram as like a sign of goodwill. So me following Shannon on Instagram is a really important piece of information I'm going to ask you to put a pin in because I accidentally skipped over something. So let's rewind a year. At that point, I was completely unaware of like what Andrew was doing, who he was dating, let alone that he was dating Shannon. And one of my videos had all of a sudden gotten like this huge influx of views, like 200,000 or something. And again, I was still a relatively small channel. I was green. I was so excited. So I posted my video just went a little viral or my video went viral, I think is the first thing that I posted. And then when I thought about it, I'm like, no, it's more like mini viral. So I came in and made like a second tweet saying it went mini viral. And all of a sudden, out of the blue, Andrew started following me and then responded to me and one of my viewers congratulating me. And he said, buying 100,000 views for a few hundred dollars isn't viral, Judd, just FYI. And then I'm not sure, I blocked Andrew somewhere. And so he was able to make another tweet at me, replying just to me this time. He says, also, why do you keep blocking me? Hey, everyone, she's a blocker and a meanie. Hashtag Black Lives Matter, because I guess he thought that was funny. And then all of a sudden, moments later, I get a DM on Twitter from an account literally named notviral_Emily. And in this DM, it has my Social Blade stats. Basically circling and insinuating that I had paid for these views because I guess at this point Andrew had no idea how the YouTube algorithm works and sometimes a video is just heavily promoted. This just dawned on me. Wouldn't it be crazy if they spent money to buy views for my channel so they could accuse me of spending money to buy views for my channel? Let me be clear right now, by the way, I have never bought views, bought subscribers, bought any form of promotion. I've never bought an ad for myself. I don't do that. I'm adamant about that. So pretty irritating having someone come in and accuse me of that. And so then this not viral Emily, aka Aja, says, so you paid for these. That much is obvious. And I say, no, I actually didn't. If you look my video, You Are Not an Artist, around that same time, you'll see it got really big. All those subs were most likely gained from that video. I have a child now. I gotta spend my cash on diapers and formula, dude. It's a waste of money to buy subs. Not viral Emily responds, sure. What you just said further implies buying subs, you see. The idea behind just buying views / subs for one video would be smart, if it wasn't so horribly shown. So you're telling me none of those viewers browse your other videos? Because looking at them, they didn't. Nice try, though. Better luck next time. Also, 200,000 isn't viral. It's silly no one else has called you out on it, because damn, it is so obvious. Hey guys, future Emily here again. So while I was recording, I noticed something really interesting. So for the screenshot that I took of my Social Blade stats back at the time this sock puppet account was accusing me of buying subs and views, you can notice the spike in subs and views starts at the end of September and goes into the first week of October, until about the 7th, and then it goes down from there. Unfortunately, I only took that one screenshot, but if I look at my analytics, it looks like somewhere in there is where I got that spike in views and subscribers. Now, if we go over to the screenshots I took of Anthony's messages, as well as the Sock Puppet account's messages, you'll see I took those screenshots on October 23rd, 2017, and that was the last time that these screenshots were at all messed with. Now, just because I remember to take screenshots on that day doesn't mean that is when I received those messages. But if we look at this screenshot right here, you can see that the Sock Puppet account sent me their original message on Saturday at 10:58 a.m. Now, for something like that, I probably would have responded right away, so I didn't see it until 8:59 p.m., but it was still on the Saturday. Now, October 23rd in 2017 fell on a Monday, so I can only assume that the messages sent by the Sock Puppet and Anthony came then the Saturday before the 23rd, which was the 21st. Can I just say that I'm super glad most social media now includes the date next to the timestamp? Because remember, after Anthony was tweeting at me accusing me of buying subscribers, only moments later did a Sock Puppet account accuse me of the same thing. Nobody else did. Just Anthony and the Sock Puppet account. And you can see that I was reacting to both of them at very similar times, because like I said, I responded to that Sock Puppet account at 8:59 p.m. and then privately messaged Anthony at 9:30 p.m. on that same day. I just find it oddly suspicious that Anthony just decides out of the blue to go looking for me a week and a half within the first time one of my videos quote unquote blow up, because now I'm second guessing everything. As you can see, there is a pattern of behavior. Anytime I experience even a modicum of success, he just has to destroy it. He has to attempt to crush my motivation. That seems like their main goal is to absolutely crush my motivation and get me to stop doing the things that I like and that I love. Any good thing that happens to me, they have to find out the hack, my email, my Facebook, find out what's good in my life and try to ruin it. Relationships, YouTube, anything, my income, they just don't want me to succeed. And this seems to be a pattern. Just by the way, you know, all the LolCow posts, I was reading through them. This is a pattern. But anyway, so I decided to unblock Andrew and confront him. Now, I do not have what I said to him, but I essentially said something like, "Why are you harassing me? Why are you doing this to me? We loved each other once. Can we not respect that? Can we just respect each other and go our separate ways? I just want to be left alone," essentially. And I know that sounds way too light and airy and soft, but I'm afraid of him. I was and I am still afraid of him. He talked about in detail shooting up his school, who he would shoot. You know, oh, if I could go back and shoot up these people. He is the kind of person to just snap, get in the car, drive cross country and kill me. I literally have a written up statement saying if anything mysterious happens to me, this is who you should be worried about. This is who your suspect should be. That may sound totally paranoid to some of you. And trust me, I get paranoid with some of these receipts, but he was a scary guy to be with. I felt trapped in a lot of instances, especially since I was vulnerable. And even here, when I'm starting to get sober, I'm vulnerable. My mind is recovering. Okay? I was still in a vulnerable position, so I was still very frightened. He says back, harassing. No, I've only posted in what my accounts are, like what has my face on it. And I'm not angry. I was just curious. I figured maybe if I get more ridiculous, I'd get a response. I wanted to see where your stuff went, which is why I was bummed you blocked me. But no, I'm not angry at all. Thank you for the reason, though. Much appreciated. Good luck out there. If I get more ridiculous, I'd get a response. That's just pure entitlement right there. And it terrified me. It said that if I don't pay attention to this man in some way, shape, or form, give him sympathy, I don't even know what he wants, a reaction, anything, he will up the ante. And that's terrifying. Fast forward a year again, I had followed Creepshow Art on Instagram. Scrolling through Instagram one day, and I notice a drawing that resembles Andrew, because Andrew had a very specific look to him. And I was like, oh, who drew this? What a coinkydink. Creepshow Art. I read the caption, and it says something about working with, and she tags Andrew. And my fucking heart falls out my ass. What's interesting, though, is at that point, I didn't accuse Shannon right away. I was actually, if anything, I was concerned about Shannon, and I mentioned that in later receipts. I was worried because I know how Andrew can be, and he had just put me through so much. When we were, Andrew and I were kind of still in a flirtatious place, at one point, he had come over. I was at my dad's house. I had been using. He crawled through my window. I've discussed this before. That is how I got people in and out of my room secretly. He climbed in through my window, and he had sex with me while I was incredibly and obviously intoxicated by way of heroin. I was nodding off. I was incoherent. And I only, whether it be from being on drugs or it being a trauma, I only remember bits and pieces of it. I don't know if he was with Shannon at that point. I do think she is aware of the encounter, as I have received, again, YouTube comments. I believe it was just one comment basically saying that I forced another girl's boyfriend to cheat on her. So that was kind of a very specific rumor. And again, like, these things just never caught traction most of the time. And I'm sorry, I don't have receipts for a lot of these YouTube comments. I don't remember what video they're on. Most of my videos have hundreds of comments, so I don't really know exactly how to rifle through all of them. Also, before I spoke to a lawyer and then eventually police, I was not screenshotting anything. I was afraid, so I was mostly just going through, deleting and blocking, just trying to get this person to leave me alone, because everyone's advice was just disengage, block, delete and block. Just get them as far away from you as humanly possible. And it wasn't until I had a consultation with a lawyer that they were like, no, don't do that. Screenshot. Keep track of everything. And I believe that was in 2017 that I really started keeping track of these receipts. So unfortunately, yes, some of this is hearsay, but I also have a shit ton of proof that Andrew and Shannon are behind this. Speaking of which, let's move on to Snapchat. One day I just received a completely random Snapchat photograph of what looked like a specific square in the city that I lived in with some nonsensical text overlaid on top. I don't have the initial Snapchat because I just kind of froze in panic, but I do have the response to that Snapchat. I wrote, "Are you in my city?" And Kilgore Trout is the name that they chose this time. And they said, "Somewhere, I suppose, in its labyrinth." And then you can see I started typing back, "You are fucking insane." Now, I'm sorry for the ableist language I was using here. I was so freaked out. You guys have no idea the level of fear that I had in this moment. I was 100% convinced that this person, Andrew or Shannon or whoever, was in my city and they were going to hurt me. You can see I said, "Answer me. You drove all the way here?" And they said, "I don't have a driver's license yet. My parents drove me here." And here is where I believe that they're starting to set up breadcrumbs that the person who was stalking me is a minor. which I find just, I mean, this is what's disturbing. Shannon and Andrew both, and specifically Shannon, really, I mean, really, the manipulation, the intense orchestration of all of this, the sock puppet accounts, this is disturbing to me. Because they set up, they covered their tracks as far back as, I think this was 2017. This is how deeply disturbed these individuals are. So I say, why? And then they say, I have prolonged fits of daydreaming at times. Just this really, and I know it may not seem scary to some people, but to me, this is so messed up. I 100% believe that this person was in my city looking for me so that they could kill me. Like I had mentioned before, Andrew and his friend Brandon discussed at length about going into their old high school and shooting it up. They also completely idolized Heath Ledger's Joker from The Dark Knight. They just thought he was like the most chaotic evil, the most amazing, cool villain ever. Andrew had discussed donning a mask, kidnapping the people who made fun of him in high school, and torturing them. This is what was coming to the forefront of my mind when I was receiving these Snapchats. I'm going to include some of the photograph Snapchats now. I don't know if they're in the right order because there was a lot of just nonsensical talk, and they don't have their original file names, so I'm not exactly sure, but I think I have them in the right order because eventually he stopped talking to me through the Snapchat chat and just through the images. And you can see how I'm so afraid of him. I start to do that tend and befriend thing. I try to approach him with a softness, just trying to get to that part of him, that little piece of him that is human. And I know some people are going to use this to doubt my validity and be like, well, if you're really scared, why were you being so nice to him? Again, I was trying so hard to tap into that human emotion so he wouldn't come to my fucking house. I was terrified. I'm sorry, but you would never know what you would do in that situation until you're actually in it. So I just want to say that. I'm looking here. I'm a little confused because I have two screenshots. The one where I say, are you in my city? And then he says somewhere, I suppose, in its labyrinth. But I also have a screenshot from the exact same day that I say, are you in my city? And then I say, that's no proof that you're here, assuming I'm responding to a Snapchat photograph. And then I say, it breaks my heart that you do this, that you want to hurt me. I wish you'd put that energy into your music. You have so much potential and you're wasting it all on this obsession with me. I don't know. Maybe I asked, are you in my city twice? I'm not 100% sure, but here are those two screenshots. At this point, I did know that Shannon and Andrew were in a relationship, but I was still kind of under the impression that Andrew was just doing this on his own and that Shannon had no idea. Now, the reason I didn't go and tell Shannon was because I, again, am terrified of this person. I didn't want to rock the boat. I literally just wanted them to leave me the fuck alone. Now, I don't have a screenshot of this, but I did send a message to him saying, do not come to my home. I have a security animal, which is 100% true. Osa is not only an emotional support dog, she is also a trained security dog. I also let him know that I have a gun in the home that I have access to and that I know how to use, and that if he tried to hurt me, that I would be forced to have to defend myself. And at this point, I had the gun. Like, I had the gun out and ready. I was fully prepared for him to come to this house and to hurt me. At this point, I was not only thinking about him fantasizing about shooting up his high school, about tormenting his ex-classmates. I was not only thinking about how he was perfectly comfortable having sex with me while I was half unconscious. I was not only thinking about the emotional abuse he put me through in our relationship, how afraid he made me. But I was also thinking about the pure dedication over, at this point, what would have been 7 or 8 years of him obsessively, constantly making sock puppet accounts, harassing me, belittling me, shaming me, trying to trigger my eating disorder. This man was the definition of obsessed. After I told him, do not come to my house, I have a security dog and a weapon in my home, he said, the valiant taste of death, but once. Cowards fear it many times. In the very first Snapchat that he sent me that I was not able to capture, there was the business Loft in it. And we have a loft here in our city in a very specific town square. So I was under the impression that he was in this town square because the architecture was very similar. This is why I was under the impression that he was in our city. So for some reason, I just don't have a screenshot of me asking this, but I said, are you near the loft in our city or your city? To which he responds with this, there is, alas, only one loft. Infinite copies of voids upon voids, reflected, as it were, into the greater void of perception, that which is named but not known, in which loft is one of any possible combination of voids, infinite yet distinct. So at this point, my emotions were very mixed. I'm like, is he trying to be funny or is he trying to be poetically terrifying? He then sends me this. All art is to be, alas, a reflection of its creators, humans who have been called to fill that void with art. For example, the mind-bending, thumb-bending video, or the alternative art of Emily Artful, who have with this art only created a greater void. Essentially saying, like, you're just adding shit content to the internet. I also realize at this point that he is pretty much trolling with the mind-bending, thumb-bending reference. I don't even know what that is. So I started to relax a little bit, and that's where I try to kind of tap into his human side because, again, I am still not 100% sure what his end game is here. What I say here is cut off, but I probably said something along the lines of, I don't understand why you think I'm so evil, that because I'm such a bad person in your eyes, that everything I create is somehow devoid of feeling. And then he sends, all art reflects the greater void of human limitations. Alas, Mother's Day cards and subscriber drawings are no exception. Only the mind-bending, thumb-bending video can transcend this void through its sheer bendery and avant-gardeness. So at this point, I'm like, okay, he's just mocking my content. Hey guys, Future Emily here again. Here is a snippet from that video Anthony posted discussing what it was like recording music while he lived in his car. In this snippet, he discusses why he's not like the other boys and why he can't get along with other musicians. Now, I don't mean to sound full of myself, but I do believe that he has me at the forefront of his mind when he is talking here. I know he's expressed these views to me in the past about other people, so I don't think he is only referring to me. But if you listen to his language, there's just a lot of hatred and anger and bitterness in his voice while he discusses this in a video that was supposed to be about him recording music in a car. Also, he brings up some really specific points that are kind of referenced in these Snapchats about like the ego and the desire to get like views and money getting in the way of making real art, which I think is so funny considering who his girlfriend is. But okay, hate to break it to you, Anthony, but I continued to make content that I liked regardless of the views. I'd pick up a sponsorship here and there to, you know, live. But your girlfriend or wife or whatever she is continued to shove her fake story times down her subscribers' throats until she realized she would get lots more views if she started sucking on the drama teat, and ended up turning her channel into one notch below a content farm because she features artwork that isn't even hers. Oh, you're doing it to support smaller creators, Shannon? Is that right? No, I think you're doing it to pump out content faster than the sour milk flows from your lolcow udders. But fuck me, right? Because I'm the sellout because I chose to show my subscribers how I make cards for all the wonderful mothers in my life on Mother's Day. Sorry, the hypocrisy just flipped a pissed off switch in me. Here's the clip.
And at a certain point, I'm pretty relieved we decided to live out of our cars in a place like America where there's clean water available pretty much at all times. And, you know, basic commodities like, you know, cars and functioning streets and things like that. Like things that are just so ubiquitous you don't even notice at this point. It actually made it manageable. And again, it wasn't easy to get out of it by any stretch of the imagination. But, you know, basic things like that seemed to make it a bit more doable. And I think what's crazy to me at this point is the amount of musicians I've known who are way more technically proficient and more gifted than I was or will ever be. And they gave up. And whether it be from just they couldn't manage criticism or, you know, quote unquote, making it didn't come fast enough. And it's like, man, all the incredible musical ideas that could have been executed if they just kept doing it and they could have just kept going.
And I'm obviously not saying that I'm some sort of success story or something like that, but because at a certain point, I'm basically a nerd with a shitty mouth that makes a bunch of noise. So I do think I'm at least competent, though. And I figure, again, if I can manage it, you know, why can't other people? I think a lot of musicians get lost in metrics and data and analytics and all this kind of stuff. And it's like, to some extent, that's important. But I think at another point, that's the ego talking. And the ego gets in the way of a lot of things. And it's just not really conducive to, I don't know, a healthy creative environment, or at least, again, trying to build resiliency or competency or anything like this. Because I think a lot of that stuff, especially when you're starting, it's a big show. And it's like, again, not to say that it's not important and ignore all of it forever. But if some of these people just kept going, I mean, they could have built something great. And I think they could have come up with fantastic works of art and fantastic pieces of music. And at a certain point, again, whether it be the ego or, you know, the show's not working or whatever, they just gave up. And it's like, you know, I'd rather have built something with my hands than just sat there and, you know, complain that things weren't going fast enough. So I don't know. That's what I got out of being homeless for a couple years. And bye.
I just wanted to show you guys that clip because I thought it was really interesting. Back to the Snapchat stuff. I felt a little bit more relaxed, like I could kind of try to tap into that softer part of him. So I said, well, I drew my subs because I know they'd like that. I made my mom a Mother's Day card because I love her. And I make every mom in my life one every year. Yeah, sometimes they aren't the artiest of arts, but they're something I and others enjoy. It's kind of that simple. I then try to tap into that human side a little bit more. I say, by the way, I didn't realize Shannon was your girlfriend until I started following her on Instagram and she posted about working with you. I kind of panicked and unfollowed her. No disrespect, of course. I just don't want any contact. And the reason I've not told her about you harassing me is because I really don't want to ruin your life. I genuinely want you to be happy. I just couldn't bring myself to do it. It didn't feel right. Just don't come to my apartment. And don't bother my family. You can keep making accounts and keep trying to prove that you're someone else. Keep telling me I'm awful or saying kill yourself. I have 100% undeniable proof it's you. You clicked the link. You gave me what I needed. I don't want to ruin your life, dude. I just want to be left alone. He says Mother's Day cards are shadow of the mind-bending, thumb-bending video. I may have to unsubscribe unless your content can reflect the profundity of the mind-bending, thumb-bending video with something that is not a lightweight craft or an update on your pregnancy. Again, I soften a little bit further and I say, lol, Andrew. Okay, I will take that suggestion to heart. But can you, like, please stop scaring me. Call me all the names in the world. Criticize my work. That's fine. But I am very protective of my family. And then I say, also, what did you think of the perfect poem? Was that okay? I feel like I put a lot of heart into that. And reading this disturbs me because I know myself. I hear and read that fear. I'm just like, please, can you stop scaring me? Please. I'm like begging him. But I'm trying so careful not to set him off at the same time. And then I'm literally trying to appease him. Like, if I make better content, if I make content that you don't deem as devoid and of emotion or of heart, that isn't unacceptable to you, will you leave me alone? Like, that is how this is reading to me. He then says, Andrew knows not of the spiritual implications of the mind-bending, thumb-bending video. He is but a prole in that sense, trapped in the mechanisms of day-to-day life. Then he says, revamping your channel into a mind-bending, thumb-bending video parody account is the only way, I'm afraid. It's the only known method of putting the art back in Artful. Then later on, he says, every star in our galaxy will simultaneously explode if you fail to take what I have suggested to heart. And again, very trolly, but at the same time, it's still a veiled threat. Because this person is so unpredictable and unstable. Do I take that as him being a troll or do I take that as a threat? I want to backtrack a little bit and talk about how I said I had undeniable proof that Andrew was the person stalking me, that he clicked a link and I was able to trace his IP, because this was the first time that I had done that. Now, after the Twitter incident where Andrew accused me of supposedly buying subs, I was very suspicious that my stalker up until that point had been Andrew. So I laid out a trap where I sent one of these profiles a link pretending to be another like separate hater of mine. And on that link, I attached an IP tracker. And because we had mutual friends, I knew exactly where Andrew and Shannon lived. So I sent over the bait. He clicked on the link. And wouldn't you know it, the IP address took me directly to where they were living. What's interesting is back when my Facebook account was hacked, I wasn't aware that Andrew was doing any of this, right? But Facebook had sent me an email basically saying, here is where the unknown login came from. The IP address pointed to the city where Andrew was from and where he resided in at the time. And I didn't think anything of it because it was 2013. I was 21. My world was small. And like all my friends came from this specific area. So it could have been anyone, really. But when everything started falling into place, it was like an anvil hit me. Of course it was Andrew. You've got to understand, it took a really long time for me to really figure out what was going on. For the longest time, I thought I had like two completely unrelated separate stalkers that were not related to one another and that they were just harassing me. And this was like part of the YouTube environment. I just kept thinking, I'm not relevant enough to have two completely unrelated stalkers. This can't be right. Now this makes so much more sense, how they had the time and the resources to make so many sock puppet accounts. I mean, just tons. And I'm frustrated with myself that I didn't document more before like 2017. The truth of the matter is I didn't want to see this shit. I didn't want to interact with these fucking sock puppet accounts that were bullying me and shaming me and fucking trying to rally people against me. So I would just delete and block and delete and block. And finally, I consulted with a lawyer and they're like, don't do that. Save everything to the best of your ability. You need to save everything. And after everything, I consulted with the lawyer. I went back to the police. I even hired a private investigator for a short time to do some digging. I, one, ran out of money, and two, was advised by the lawyer not to take this to court, that it would be a lengthy court battle, and it's not like justice will be served because it's really hard to prove that Shannon and Andrew ran all those sock puppet accounts because there was so many of them. And I fully acknowledge that probably not all of those comments were coming from Andrew and Shannon. But when you've been stalked as long as I have, you can detect your stalker's language to the point where I could start to differentiate the voices between Andrew and Shannon. And what's really interesting is it was definitely Andrew in the beginning. Like, I really think Andrew just roped Shannon into this mean girl obsession with me. And Shannon kind of became the mastermind over time. I could see the transition from Andrew into Shannon. Now, whereas Andrew was more kind of threatening and domineering, not that Shannon wasn't, not that Shannon didn't love to make vague threats against me, Shannon was more catty and mean girl. That all changed when the Rewired Soul drama happened. And in case you guys didn't know, there used to be this channel, I don't know if he's still around, called the Rewired Soul. And in the beginning, he was making videos just talking about mental health, and he was in recovery like I was, and he made some pretty good videos at first. I befriended him. Then he started talking about other people's mental health without their consent, and it just all went downhill. And when I tried to hold him accountable and be like, dude, like, this isn't okay, he blamed everybody else but himself. It was just an entire mess, and I definitely regret befriending him. But since I had publicly, I think I had just tweeted at him a few times, so people were aware that him and I had talked. During that whole debacle, I got a DM on Twitter from someone named Dat Boy, and they say, uh-oh, dear, looks like you're friends with a fraud. Do you want to be hurt in the worst possible way? Somebody is a bad mommy. Maybe we let everyone know how bad of a mommy you are. Keep telling people you're sober, girl. Maybe if you say it enough, people will believe it. Have fun endorsing your fraud, druggy bitch. Have fun faking your sobriety for your mindless followers. They believe you, but no one else does, my dear. You bad mommy. I've got receipts, druggy bitch, with a winky face. Hey guys, future Emily here again. I know you're probably thinking, how do you know all these comments and DMs and things are coming from Shannon and Anthony? How do you know they're not just regular hate comments? The part of the art community that I belong to, you know, with Monique and Bailey and Hello Alice and Doodle Date, Super Ray Dizzle, Casey Golden, Ace of Clay, I could go on and on. That part of the art community, I feel, is a generally really positive one. It doesn't mean we don't have our fair share of drama sometimes. It doesn't mean that we don't have hate comments. They just look different from, say, the gaming community or even the art commentary community. Let me put it this way. When Shannon was preoccupied with something else, probably traumatizing another creator, it was very easy to tell because I would get far few comments wanting me to go check out Creepshow Art because she's copying me. I get far few comments telling me, hey, look, I've got all your videos archived. I'd get far few comments being like, you're a neglectful mother or you're trying to shove your kids down our throats. I'd get far few comments that start with, does anyone else hate when Emily does blank? Because these comments always came in clusters and the accounts that they came from were usually pretty barren. Maybe they'd have a couple playlists here and there. Extra points if that account came into existence within a month of commenting. Not only that, but I'm sure you've already been able to tell that Anthony has a very specific way that he types, a very specific way that he phrases things. He likes to wax poetic with a hint of trolling in there. Shannon is typically a lot more long-winded. She likes to make a lot of excuses to try to cover her bases. The one thing they have in common in their phrasing, though, is they're incredibly condescending. They like to talk down. They like to shame. Like Anthony's tweet to me, for instance. 200,000 views isn't viral, Judd. Snarky, condescending, patronizing. He wants you to know that you're pathetic. Whereas Shannon's language is a lot more overt. Have you guys seen Emily's shitty jewelry and charms? Like, do people actually buy these? I also think Shannon really gets a kick out of seeming like she's helping you and being a good person, when in reality she's just reciting all the dirt that she has on you, just to remind you that she could bury you in a second. But if you try to speak up for yourself, she's like, oh my god, you took it the wrong way. Wow. You'll see a few really great examples of that later on in this video, but I'd also highly recommend checking out Hopeless Peach's video on the matter. Peach's shows a few really good examples of her trying to calmly stand up for herself, only to be met with gaslighting from Shannon. I'm sorry I keep popping in here like this, but I feel like this specifically is something that needed to be said so you know what to look for going forward. You can even see the shift from Anthony to Shannon as the years go on. Now, my addiction was something that I think fueled Andrew and Shannon's obsession with me. I think they looked down on me for it. And I think they thought that made me less than. I think they thought that made me like a party girl, which is, I mean, the opposite of what my addiction was like. And I think that kind of gave them like a free pass in their mind to treat me like shit. So it was something a lot of their sock puppet accounts like to bring up, trying to disprove my sobriety. Also, I don't know if you guys are noticing kind of a speech pattern here, but when they talk to me, it's very condescending. It's very snarky, accusatory a lot of the time, and threatening, just like a very veiled, vague threat. Except in this instance, it's not veiled. It is a direct threat. I'm going to hurt you in the worst way. And I interpreted that because they kept saying mommy, mommy, to mean they were either going to hurt my children or find a way to get my children taken away from me. Because this is not the first instance that Shannon has alluded to me being a bad mother. Many years ago, I made a few videos that I have since deleted that were just totally for fun. It was like kind of a silly, not like alternate reality game, but I changed my channel for Halloween. And I did this thing with my, at the time, I think he was like a year old, my first son, Beanie, let's call him Beanie. And we did this really fun, like literally like a collaboration between mommy and baby. And it was about like how he's got the spawn of Satan inside of him and we have to exorcise him. And if you guys were around then, you know, it was totally harmless, super cute. My baby and I had lots of fun. And it wasn't like this thing that I was like trying to get so much money for. I knew it was quote unquote off brand. It was silly. It was cute. I'm sure it exists somewhere. I'm sure somebody made a copy. And if you watch it, it was just dumb and campy and fun. And I'm glad I did it. I'm still glad I did it. We had so much fun making it. And I've shown my son since, and he just thinks it's the funniest thing. But for some reason, I just kept getting the same comment over and over and over. Oh, my God. Aren't you guys so, like, grossed out that she's trying to monetize her kids? Like, oh, my gosh, she's just shoving her kids down our throat. And I'm sorry, I do one thing. I did that one thing, that little series. It was like three episodes with my son who, I mean, my kids are my life. Like, I think about them constantly. They are my greatest inspiration, my greatest motivation. They have saved me. My babies are my everything. And so to have that, like, accusation lobbed at me was frustrating. On my old Redbubble account, I had made a shirt with my son's face on it, and he has a little lollipop, and I think it says, "One cool dude." I never made that public. Like, I never advertised it as merch. I put that in my Redbubble shop and ordered two of those shirts, one to send to my dad and one to send to my best friend, because obviously they love my son. I didn't ever advertise this, ever, ever, ever. But Shannon took this and was just hell-bent on being like, look, she's trying to monetize her kids. She's trying to get money, make money off her kids. Like, I'm so sick of these pregnancy updates. It might be really hard for you to see your channel as anything but a money-making machine, Shannon, but that's not what my channel is. That's why I did the cute little series with my son. That's why I did pregnancy updates, is because my channel is more to me than just a fucking money machine. I know things like that don't get that many views, but I don't care. I genuinely enjoy sharing that little piece of my life with you guys every now and again. I love being a mom. That is part of my life. That is part of my existence. So I'm happy to share it with you guys in bits and pieces. But if I do that even a little bit, Shannon would just jump out of the woodwork to either accuse me of being neglectful, abusive, or trying to monetize my kids like I was fucking daddy of five or something. I just thought that was the most ridiculous claim. If you look at her lolcow post, she really likes to paint me as a really bad mother. For instance, she says, Emily Artful uploaded two videos trying to explain her absence, when in reality, she left because her views are terrible. Before she left, she was tweeting and deleting about how bad her views were because no one wants a podcast of her talking with other artists. People want fake story times from her, and that's it. That's why none of her other content breaks 100,000 views. So she makes a video saying she almost killed her child two times because she got him sick, then when no one cared, pretended it was creator burnout. That is just a flat-out lie. And this is what is so disturbing. She would watch my videos and then go to lolcow, it seems, and just lie about what was in the videos, because most people can't even be bothered to go and watch and make sure what she's saying is the truth. And pretty much everything she has literally ever said about me is exactly that. She takes a sliver of truth to make it believable. So she takes something that I may have said before in a video or tweeted out before, and then she lies. She attaches lies to it because most people could not be bothered to go back and check. So they move on with a really negative opinion of me. And that's exactly what she wants. The video she's referencing, I posted back in July of 2019. It's called These Past 2 Months Animated. And already in the thumbnail, it's got my little Bubby's character, like, stressed out with the words too much over it. So no, it's not like I posted that video and then all of a sudden nobody cared, so I backtracked and said it was something different. The whole video was to express that I was burnt out. Not just creator burnout, but just burnt out in general. And no, Shannon, I did not almost kill my kid two times by deliberately getting him sick. What the fuck? What video were you watching? Sorry, I started to lose my cool for 2 seconds, but I didn't try to deliberately get my kid sick and kill him twice. That is such a bizarre accusation. But again, just constant accusations and comments about me being an abusive mother, me being a neglectful mother, me being a terrible mother. And if it's one thing that I'm confident in, if it could be nothing else, I will stand on the tops of the highest mountain and say it at the top of my lungs, I know I am a good mom. So I think it's important you guys remember that Shannon likes to take a sliver of truth so things seem credible and then sprinkle in all her lies. This will be important later. On October 24th, 2018, I posted a video called My Problem with a Big YouTuber. Don't go looking for it. It's private. It caused way too much trouble. And for people waiting on bated breath, no, that video was not about Shannon. I have never posted a video about Shannon or Andrew. I've been way too terrified to poke the bear. But yeah, I ended up privating the video because over time it caused a lot of turmoil, especially for my friends and colleagues who were completely innocent, especially Kat Vok. I love Kat Vok. She's talented, intelligent. She makes great videos. Go check her out. But for some reason, people were targeting her specifically. Now, there were a few legitimate, real little YouTube accounts commenting and being like, hey, is this Creepshow art? But I would say 50% of the people saying Creepshow art were definitely sock puppets. She had the audacity to even use Lily Singh as a handle, which I thought was weird. And she'd comment stuff like, Creepshow art, more like crap show art, am I right? But anyway, of course, Shannon had to react to her sock puppet accounts accusing her on her Instagram story, apparently. At this point in the saga, I kept Shannon at arm's length. I didn't really want anything to do with her. I just acknowledged that she was another art YouTuber that exists and that was with my abusive ex-boyfriend. I wasn't 100% sure if she was in on it or she was actually also a victim. But I was definitely leaning towards the idea that Shannon was involved somehow because I noticed over the years that my stalker's language sort of changed, how they spoke to me changed, but that snarkiness, the accusations, that all kind of stayed the same. So the beginning, I don't know if you've noticed, but it was like very scary, like, you know, like someone who's going to shoot up a school. And in my opinion, a little bit more of like a masculine, domineering, like vague, aloof, but terrifying kind of voice into a more catty, mean girl, bitchy voice. So that led me to start to think that maybe Shannon was involved. So because of all this uncertainty and me not knowing what role Shannon played in all of this, I didn't follow her on social media, but I didn't block her either. I wanted that line of communication accessible in the event that something, you know, terrible happened, then I could confront slash let her know what's going on. Because again, didn't know if she was involved, didn't know if she was totally oblivious. So of course, her Instagram story totally went unnoticed by me. And if she messaged me with one of her sock puppets, well, I didn't see it because at this point I had made it publicly known that my DMs were closed. Didn't even check message requests. Why? Because Andrew and Shannon have literally changed my brain chemistry because of their incessant harassment. Before, I would get a new message from someone I didn't know and I would be excited. Now when I get a message from someone I don't know, I feel deep, sickening anxiety. Shannon's post reads, "The people linking me to Emily Artful's video, I've seen it, and no, it wasn't me," plays Shaggy in background. "I've said multiple times that I won't collaborate with other YouTubers because I don't enjoy the implications people get from it. Even if this isn't what the person is thinking at the time, collaborating with someone is a business move. You gain from that partnership, and I never want to be in a position where someone thinks I owe my following, money, and success because of someone else. That's gross. Also, less exciting, and something I might open up more about, but for about 12 years now, I've been harassed online by the girl who catfishes me. I know it's her because she ended up admitting to it last year when I called her out on it, saying it was because she was stressed and didn't have another outlet for it. Also, she felt betrayed because I stopped responding to her emails after a while. Because of her harassing me, my boyfriend, my friends, and sometimes going as far as to try to get me fired, I don't trust people very easily online." Isn't that a coinky dink? That right there is the most passive-aggressive shit I have ever read and is also one of the many breadcrumbs that she started leaving behind that she had a quote-unquote stalker named Amy. I think it's funny that she picked the name Amy. I think she deliberately picked a name that was very close to mine so that if I ever came out with allegations, she could be like, see, I even chose Amy because it sounds like Emily. And of course, she picked all the things that she did to me so then I couldn't even come out if I wanted to, because then it would seem like I was copying her instead of her copying me. Now, the reason I think she started leaving breadcrumbs when she did is because that Snapchat exchange that I had with Andrew, I obviously screenshotted all of that. What does Snapchat do when you screenshot? It notifies the other party. So at that point, they would have been made aware that I was compiling evidence against them. I had also stated publicly, whenever I had just mentioned my stalker in passing, that the way I am trying to protect myself is saving everything. Now, because I didn't see Shannon's Instagram story right away, she ended up DMing me herself on Instagram. Now, because we had that conversation about her potentially changing the name of her story, Storytime series, the message thread that Shannon and I had was not in message requests. Therefore, I was notified about it. Shannon says, "Gah, I'm sorry. I went on a rant from your video. For some reason, people are trying to insert me into it, which I get because I am kind of a bitch. There's a fucking girl on here / YouTube and now Twitter who is just fucking relentless with this shit, and it's just goddamn annoying at this point. So I was just putting my two cents out there. Nothing but respect for you and your video. You're fucking dope as hell, and I'd never try to step on your toes. Really, Shannon? Also, props to you for not saying the name. That's a fucking classy move, my dude. You're 100% more mature than I am." That's another thing. I notice a lot of the like comments. If you guys can find like YouTube comments that are really like shitty and bitchy and have the word "my guy" or "my dude," like that is Shannon. That is absolutely 100% Shannon. I think she realized that that was like outing her over time. So she even left a comment at one point on one of my videos referencing me saying "my dude," because I've said it maybe once or twice ever. And she said, "Ugh, like people who say my dude like have an IQ of like 4. It was something really catty and terrible. So I just thought that was kind of funny. And after I read those messages, I just couldn't take it anymore. My adrenaline right now is literally like just so high because I remember that exact moment. My hand is literally shaking. I just feel like I could lift a car right now. I couldn't take it anymore. So I finally just decided I need to confront her because everything was falling into place. I knew exactly what she was doing. This exchange is going to be long. It is 41 screenshots long, so I'm going to try to get through it quickly, but I just want you to pay attention to how easily she manipulated me, took advantage of my kindness, of my willingness to give her the benefit of the doubt, and notice how she uses her fake stalker story to try to get some sympathy from me, weaken me, and then further manipulate me. Also, apologies in advance. On the bottom where my empty text bubble should be, it says, "because like I said, I don't want to hurt or ruin anyone's lives," for every single screenshot. And there's like Shannon's little bubble above it. I don't know why that happened, but it's there. And for the sake of authenticity and time, I'm just going to go ahead and leave it in. "Are you the one that's been stalking me? Or is it Andrew? We can be candid now because I know it's one of you. Those fake accounts you've been making have led me right to Oregon. I suspected it was him at first when he went on a spree on his main account on Twitter, trying to convince my followers I bought my subscribers and my views. Almost immediately after he did that, a mysterious new Twitter account accused me of the same thing, also with an IP from that area in Oregon. When I first started to get harassed, you both must still have been in San Jose, because that IP came from somewhere in San Jose. But at the time, I had no idea who it was. But now, over time, in order to protect myself and my family, I decided to get smarter. So I just really don't know if it's you or him. Either way, I've been giving all this information to the police, including the more accurate IP from that Lily Singh account. All I ask is to be left alone by you and your boyfriend. It's been 8 years." I also forgot to mention that I baited that Lily Singh account into clicking a link with an IP tracker that led me straight to their new location because they had since moved. Now, interestingly enough, one of the IPs that I had tracked to where they had lived before was from a library. Come to find out that when Shannon and Andrew were living in their car, they had used a library for their internet access, which I now know from watching some of Shannon's older videos.
Because when you live in a car, you don't have very basic things. Like, you don't have a kitchen, and you don't have a living room, and you don't have a bed, and you don't have a bathroom. So you have to kind of find ways to make up for those things. So for a kitchen, you know, you can fool yourself and say, "Oh, I'm going to have salads at Walmart. I'll just go and eat really healthy." But most of the time you're having Taco Bell. For a living room, you have a Starbucks or a library because you can sit there essentially the entire day and no one cares.
So what our schedule basically was on a day-to-day basis was basically to get food at about 9 a.m. or so and make our way over to the library and set up so we could essentially work till about 2 or 3 and then get food again and then come back and work till about, I don't remember if it was 9 p.m. or 10 p.m. when it closed, but we would basically work there all day.
So that's an even stronger confirmation for me that, in fact, the person who was stalking me all this time was definitely Shannon and Andrew. Shannon says, literally neither, dude. I say, then why did your boyfriend go off on me randomly for, quote unquote, buying subs and views, like from his actual account? This happened almost a year ago. Shannon says, look, honestly, I'm sorry from what you've gone through. I don't know you all that well. But accusing us of doing shit we don't know about isn't cool. Like, Andrew already told me that you thought he did it, and honestly, I didn't worry about it because it didn't seem like that big of a deal. Also, about the sub-buying thing, I got message about that as well. Like, 5 accounts messaged me, and I know they messaged other art YouTubers. They also messaged me edits of shit about you from before the Emily Artful account. Shit that is literally none of my business. That makes no fucking sense. Why would this person who has shit on me send stuff to Shannon but no other commentary drama channel? If they really had shit on me, don't you think they would really want to try to get it out there? No, this is just, one, a cover-up, and two, this is her in a very roundabout, sneaky way. This is how manipulative she is. Telling me that she still has those photographs of me. Hey, do you know those photographs where you're in compromising outfits and positions, and in some of those pictures you're a minor? Yes, I still have those. I said, look, all I am saying is I want to be left alone. If it's not you, then great. But I just find it strange. I have zero contact with Andrew, and then he just explodes at me randomly from his personal account with his name attached to it. Shannon says, I feel ya, but I can guarantee it's not him. If you want to Skype or FaceTime, I'm up for it, because literally I have nothing to hide on this end. Yeah, you do, Shannon. Yeah, you do. And with that being said, Andrew has a trollish sense of humor. He thought it was funny, but I guess it crossed a line. I said, really? I don't believe that, because literally no other art YouTuber has said anything about that to me. I'm friends with a handful of them. Why just you? Please understand why this sounds strange. Shannon says, no, I get it. I had screenshots from them that they had sent to other people, and then when I went to report them, they deleted the account. I said, yeah, I get it would be like him if I had had any contact with him. He wasn't even following me at the time. It was 100% random. 100%. It was very confusing to me. I want you guys to remember what she says here. Shannon says, their name was also like Filter. They also had like a sob story about how you wronged them once upon a time. Again, none of this was my business. And Andrew told me about how you were harassed back in the day. So I just thought it was another one of those anime fanboys who wanted attention. Again, he thought it was funny. They had sent him shit and we don't have the time to mess with you, honest to God. We've been homeless on and off, working shitty jobs and working on our art a lot. Like, we don't have time to obsess over you and your really cute family. I want to say no offense, but like, that's not offensive. Shannon continues, I get where you're coming from with the accusation. I have been harassed by a girl who catfished me for about 12 years now. I find that really interesting because 4 months after this, she made her I was stalked, you know, for 8+ years story time. I know exactly how long I have been stalked by you, Shannon. I think it's weird that you put 8+ in your title when you tell me 12 years. Why wouldn't you just say I have been stalked for 12 years in your title? I don't know. I just thought that inconsistency was interesting. Shannon continues, to the point where she tried to convince my mom I was a cam girl and photoshopped nudes of me. See, I find things like this interesting because I was a cam girl for a short period of time. And I also, by Shannon or Andrew, had my nudes sent back to me, photoshopped, like in a mocking way, making fun of my body. Shannon continues, I wouldn't do that to someone else. It doesn't feel great, and it led me to trying to kill myself back in the day. Shannon and Andrew absolutely knew the anguish and the stress and the anxiety they inflicted upon me from stalking me, and they knew that it drove me to the brink of suicide a number of times. So I can't speak to Shannon's mental health and what she has been through, but when she brought that up, it literally felt like she was taking a burning hot poker and stabbing me in an open wound. Shannon continues, I can't really explain why Andrew is as random as he is, though. That one's a mystery. I think he just thought it would be funny. It wasn't, but he'd never intentionally try to hurt you. He's got a lot of respect for you. Like, you've collaborated with him in his music. You know how important that is to him. He's not the type of person who lets someone in like that and then switches on him, you know? If that makes sense. I feel like it does. I don't know. Like I had mentioned at the beginning of the video, now that I look back and know who was harassing me, it makes me feel sick to my stomach that I collaborated with Andrew on his music video and on his music and things like that. I think it gave him some sort of sick pleasure to know that like I could just waltz in his room and work with him professionally, just feel totally comfortable having a nice chat with him after we were done working. And then I go home and he's got this immense control over me. I think he got off on that. I said, I'm going to be filing a restraining order. I just have too much evidence to believe otherwise. I will not be pressing any charges because, like I said, I don't want to hurt or ruin anyone's lives. I'm just a little afraid now that I'm a mother. I want to protect my children and my family at any cost. The restraining order will prevent Andrew and you by association of IP from contacting me, but that's okay because we don't really need to talk anyway. So if it's not you, you have nothing to worry about because a private investigator will locate the address and the new IP. And if it's not you guys, then the hunt continues. Here's where I start to show a little bit of doubt and weakness, and she just totally pounces on it. I said, look, if I'm wrong, please forgive me. I know I seem crazy, but it's been 8 years of harassment, and I have an obligation not only to myself, but to my children. That's why I've done nothing up until this point. I didn't care that it was just happening to me, but my kids are my whole life. Shannon said, no, I completely understand. I said, I'm sorry. I know I sound insane if you really have nothing to do with this, but I just have to go with my gut. Again, if it's really not you guys, then that will prove itself. Shannon said, do what you need to do, but it isn't me. It isn't Andrew. That's all I can vouch for. If anything, he's more confused as to why you think it's him when he had you in a video while you were being harassed and he got shit from it, you know? So this is the second time she brings up me working with Andrew while I was being harassed, and she uses it as a way to kind of clear their name. What I find odd is that she remembers those two things were happening simultaneously, because if I'm really just like, yeah, just my boyfriend's ex, like whatever, I don't think that would be something that would be in the forefront of her memory. I just think it's weird that she was able to recall it so easily and use it as a way to like clear their name. And also this kind of just confirms that Andrew got sick pleasure, or both of them got sick pleasure from me coming over and working with him while they secretly harass me online, because she remembers it so readily. Just some food for thought. Shannon says, and I feel ya, I really do. I get where you're coming from on this, but no one here has the time to mess with you. I said, yeah, I promise you there are things that don't make sense to me either. There are several things that make me think it's not Andrew, but there are just a lot of uncanny coincidences, and it may just be that, coincidences. But this is the route I've decided to take, and the truth is, even though I'm mostly convinced, I still respect his intelligence, his art, your intelligence, your art, your lives. I don't want to get in anyone's way. I just want to make stupid art videos for my internet friends. I want to live in peace. I can take the hate, but I can't take the fear of losing my job and not being able to support my kids or losing my kids. Shannon said, honestly, there's no way for me to prove it's not me, but it'll sort itself out. No, I completely understand that point. You have a family. As someone who's sensitive issues, that's a huge deal for me. I would never try to hurt someone like that. But there is no way you can actually know that for sure, because you don't know me. And then because of what she mentioned, I start to soften a little bit, have some sympathy for her. And I say, yeah, I know, Shannon. I know you don't, and I'm sorry. I really am sorry. If I'm wrong, I'm so, so sorry. But I just have to do this. When I first suspected Andrew, I actually worried about you. Part of me wanted to reach out to make sure you were okay, but I wasn't sure what was real or what wasn't. Shannon said, all I know is that he has too much respect for you to do that. I don't know you well enough to spend that much time on it, and you need to do what's right for you. No, I completely understand. If I thought your partner was doing that, I'd probably want to reach out too. You don't have to be sorry. I understand. I completely get it. When I was going through shit, I once accused my sister of being behind it, so I understand. Then I said I thought it was maybe Andrew and Brandon for a time, especially because Brandon is so intense and that can be contagious. And then when I brought up Brandon, it was like she saw an out and pounced on it. Shannon said, I think it's Brandon. Last year, Brandon tried to get me fired because Andrew essentially chose me over him. Also, he tried to have an art YouTube, and it hasn't been going well. We all moved to location together, lived in cars together, and he essentially tried to drive Andrew and I apart. I wouldn't be surprised if it was him. I asked, where does Brandon live now? Shannon said, mainly because he's tried shit with me before and Andrew had to step in. I don't know. Somewhere in location still. But I don't talk to him or look at his shit. I had to block him because he started messaging my followers telling them I was a cunt and shit. Sounds really familiar. Shannon continues. He directly tried to sabotage my channel a couple of times. Sounds really familiar. I said, could he possibly live in location? I know that's where you guys were originally headed. Shannon says, I think so, yeah. I don't know for sure, but it's a couple hours away. I said, his last name was spelled last name, right? Shannon said, yes. Oh, apparently he lives in location. I just asked Andrew. Neither of us has talked to him for a year or so. I said, okay, I'll give that information to the PI. Look, you don't know how badly I want to believe it's not you guys. I wanted to believe it was some random nut job. Shannon said, yeah, I completely understand. Completely. Do what you need to do. And as for Brandon, if he is or was behind it, we didn't know. Andrew wouldn't have let you near him, and I just didn't like being around Brandon in general. Shannon continues, you need to keep yourself safe and do what feels right. Getting a PI and protecting your family is exactly right. I have nothing but respect for that. No judgment, no bullshit. I understand. I've been through it, and had she not admitted to doing it, I would be where you are now. So right there, she admits that Amy had admitted doing it. So if Amy really is me and I'm the one harassing her, then Shannon, you must have evidence of me admitting to stalking you somewhere, because right there, you claimed that your stalker admitted it.
If you're asking yourself, Shannon, where are the emails? Where are they in this video? I want to see one of these emails. That brings me to another giant mistake that I kept making this entire time. Every email I got, every derogatory, deranged email about wanting me to die, I read once and I deleted it. At the time, I didn't realize how fucking stupid that was, and I didn't think what was happening was a crime or like important. I very much downplayed what was happening because it was happening to me. It wasn't illegal or fucked up because it was happening to me. I thought it was embarrassing, and I thought if people knew about it, it would be embarrassing for me. I'd be like a bitch on the internet who can't take a joke, and I didn't want people to know I had all these faults that were so alarmingly accurate being pointed out in email and email.
I said, yeah, but it's surprisingly a lot more complicated and expensive. Again, I ran out of money. Then they make it look on TV. So fucking expensive. But yeah, look, please tell Andrew I'm sorry as well. If I'm wrong, I'm a scared fucking idiot. Shannon said, no, you're not an idiot. This has been happening for years, so you're not dumb at all. I'm still paranoid to the point where I don't tell people online shit until it's 2 years old because I don't want them tracking me. I said, thank you for understanding. I wish you both literally nothing but good things and happiness. I truly do, from the bottom of my heart. That's all any of us could ever want. Shannon said, back at you. We have similar experiences. Way to cover your ass, Shannon, which is terrible, but it's at least some common ground. And back at you. You have a supportive husband, very cute baby, and a great career. You should be extremely proud of yourself. I'm oddly proud of you, and I don't even know you. If you ever need more info on either Andrew, Brandon, or I, either to clear my name or even if it makes us look worse, let me know. I said, yes, exactly. Lol. Thank you, Shannon. You both are wildly talented and intelligent people. And I'd ask for more information, but I worry about doing wrong to you unjustly. Like, I could just ask for your exact address and have Andrew served with papers, but I truly worry if I was wrong, I'd feel awful. I'll just let the PI and the police take care of it. This person, whoever it is, has been doing less in recent years, so I'm just hoping they stop altogether. It's motherhood that's made me distressed and paranoid more than anything. Okay, we were missing a few of the original screenshots at the end, so I went to my Instagram. Thankfully, Shannon did not delete her Instagram. She just deleted everything off of it, so I was still able to access the old DMs, and I took new screenshots. I have since gotten a new phone, so that's why the screenshots look a little different. Shannon discloses some personal information that I don't feel comfortable sharing with the public, and she says, I'm not uber public with that because I hate the idea of people pitting me, and I'm also super private with it. And then some other private information that alluded to the previous private information, more private information. And then she asked, and sever with payers? What does that mean? And I said, no, I won't tell a soul, I promise. Then Shannon said, you're the only one who knows other than Annie. I don't know who that is. I said, oh my bad, papers. When a restraining order is set, one is served with papers, either at their place of work, home, a place they frequent, or in this case, where the IP is coming from. Shannon said, oh, okay, if I give you a P.O. box, would it be okay to serve them there? Or can we get something notarized that says something similar? That way you don't have to spend any money, you have a legal document stating we won't contact you, and if it ends up being not us, we can just let bygones be bygones. I don't know, I just realized that makes no sense. I said, actually, that would be great. Is the P.O. box in your name or Andrew's? This would probably help eliminate you guys, if anything. Shannon says, it's both of ours. My full name is Shannon, last name, if that also helps. I said, you don't understand how much I appreciate this. You really don't. Yes, the P.O. address would be great. She gives me her P.O. box. I said, like, I'm actually getting a little emotional because I've been so worried it's been you guys. Thank you so much. Man, she got me hook, line, and sinker. Actually, no, they didn't get me hook, line, and sinker. I 100% was still convinced it was them at this point. And this is something I've had to work on in therapy. I am a weak-willed person. If you are nice to me, I will fold like a house of cards. And I was also still considerably afraid of both of them at this point. So whenever they would show me like a sliver of humanity, I would just cling to it because I just wanted everything to be over. I just wanted to be left alone. So I would try to like play to their kind human side. Again, that tend and befriend response. Now I know Shannon said with her alleged stalker that they became friends and like kept in touch over email or whatever. I would never, ever, ever go that far unless I desperately had to protect myself. But I just mostly wanted them to leave me the fuck alone, and I was prepared to do anything to get that. Shannon said, no, I understand completely. I really am happy to help, even if that means following a restraining order or a notarized letter. Regardless, I know how important it is to feel safe, and you deserve that much. I said, I might be able to just hire an attorney that can write up a document so no one has to deal with police dealings, but I'll have to look into it. I'll talk to the PI next week. The P.O. box may just totally clear you right off the bat. Thank you again so much. From woman to woman, thank you for being kind. Truly. I hope you have a life filled with nothing but success. Andrew as well. You both have a great night. Shannon said, Brandon also used to be on the P.O. box. That might be important. But no problem, it's not hard to be kind, and especially in this situation. Really? It seems like it's really hard for you to be truly kind, Shannon. It's hard enough going through what you went through, and we're both more than happy and willing to sign something that says we will not contact you again in any form ever again. And back at you, I'm happy this helps, and happy this made you feel at least a little bit better. It was never my intention to make you feel any which way, but I understand where you're coming from and why you did. Never feel like you have to apologize for that. And I said, thank you so much. Good night. So after this conversation, I had a long, hard think about what I wanted to do next. Did I want to take the information that I had gathered, which was just basically a P.O. box, and that was it, who's to even say that the P.O. box really belonged to them? And should I take this information and then money that I could be using to have fun with my kids or buy them necessities and use it to pay attorney's fees so we can write up like an informal restraining order? Or I could use the money to pay an even more expensive service and hire a PI to literally physically track down Andrew and Shannon so that I can get in touch with their local police department to serve them with a restraining order. I just said, you know what? I just don't think it's worth it. So I decided to lay low for a little bit, and then I started posting again. And every once in a while, I would get like a comment that was worded a little suspiciously, but nothing too malicious. You know, I got the regular unrelated troll comments and things like that that I knew weren't them. And that was it. After that conversation with Shannon, I never received another threat or taunt again. And that, to me, just further solidified in my mind that my stalker was Shannon and Andrew. Now, I need to back up a little bit. I'm sorry I keep doing this, but keep in mind I am, you know, doing all of this off of screenshots, and sometimes the date the screenshot was taken was not the same date that the message was sent. I am kind of hastily putting this together, but I promise this information is very important. This incident happened somewhere between the Rewired Soul incident and Shannon posting on LolCal about me almost killing Beanie. On July 19th, 2018, 4 months before I confronted Shannon, I received a Twitter DM from someone named Britta Filter. Hi, future Emily here again. What's really interesting is I got a Twitter DM yesterday, June 10th, 2021 at 7:08 p.m. And this Twitter account that's been around since 2017, whose screen name is also Britta Filter, and the message reads, "Hey Emily, I was looking through Shannon's LolCal post again and realized that she posted a deleted video of yours saying that a channel was reposting them. I was wondering if you had seen this channel. Name of the copycat channel, and if it's yours or something malicious. Sorry if this is old information or not relevant, just thought I'd mention it. Take care." What's really interesting and is something to think about is this account has been used since the day it was created. Now, I'm not going to post receipts of any of this because I don't want to lead a sheep to slaughter, especially everybody listening. This may not be Shannon. This is all speculation. I do not know the age or location of this person. I did my absolute best to censor things. Obviously, it seems that Shannon likes to have a lot of sock puppet accounts, and I had always wondered if she had some dedicated sock puppet accounts that she actually used. But not only that, I quote unquote hear her voice and Anthony's sense of humor, which I guess by extension is also her sense of humor, all up and down this Twitter account. What's really suspicious to me is that the YouTube account referenced is an account that I believe Shannon and Anthony were using to archive my videos. And I have received many comments in the past trying to get me to notice this channel. They're just a bunch of videos with random gameplay footage or sometimes just a still image with my audio playing over top. But since I've been on this platform for 6 years, I have occasionally had the problematic take. So I believe that Shannon and Anthony wanted me to be bothered, like shaking in my boots, like, "Oh my gosh, what if people find these videos and cancel me?" Like, for one, I have never been afraid to admit when I'm wrong. My viewers can tell you that. That is a credible piece of evidence that you can look back in my history and see. And two, I'm not going to let Shannon and Anthony hold those things over my head anymore. Nothing I had ever done would warrant that level of stalking and harassment. I'm a big girl, Shannon. I don't want to play with you in the sandbox. Besides, cat shit in there anyway. If you want to post my old crack cocaine addled Twitter ramblings, then you go right on ahead. If you want to repost some videos I posted 4 years ago where I said some pretty toxic, self-absorbed shit, you go right on ahead. If you want to post naked pictures of me that you think are so cringy, especially because, you know, I was 15, you go right on ahead. But keep in mind, if you do that last one, I won't be the only one having to deal with the consequences. You and Anthony have held this over my head for years and years and years. I am not affected by it anymore. I have made my peace with it. So if you want to post it, you go right on ahead. But let me just say, I won't be the only one with egg on my face. Anyway, back to the original Britta Filter message I had received back in 2018. And if you recall, at the beginning of the conversation I had with Shannon, she did mention this account. She said this account specifically had sent her some dirt on me, but she had tried to report it, but then when she went back, they had deleted their account. Well, apparently not. Also, she tried to paint this account as being malicious towards me, but you'll see. Britta Filter says, "Hi Emily, you don't know me, but unfortunately, I know you. I want to explain this as clearly as possible, but it's very difficult for me to get my words out right now with everything I have found and what's going on around me. I don't expect you to reply, I just want you to know what happened, because in a weird way, it does affect you. My brother has been a quote-unquote fan of you for a while now. He has apparently watched all of your videos and has them saved on his computer. There are some of you where you're singing and it's fairly grainy, all the way up to some that I see you are currently posting on YouTube. He has pages and pages of screen names, information on you, and things that I don't think any person should have on someone. Essentially, if you put it out on the internet, he has it. I also found screenshots of when he has harassed you. He made accounts on YouTube years ago pretending to be a girl named Ava. I think she means Aja, but whatever. And bothered you then. I believe he has a list of your past employees, one being an optical shop. And though I am not sure, I believe he might have sent them things about you. He made various Twitters and sent you messages about other people and things that have nothing to do with you. He even started reaching out to various people, followers of you on YouTube and Instagram with quote-unquote proof that you buy subscribers. I know, via screenshots, that he sent these with little notes on them. If I had known about this sooner, I would have stopped it sooner. But unfortunately, our family has some communication problems. In this modern age, it's hard to find a reason to check someone else's computer for anything, but I think my parents should have been more attentive with that. I was using his computer for schoolwork and found everything. Even videos of you in a bathtub, which I thought as inappropriate, and I truly don't understand how he got those. I took the laptop and showed the information to my family, and we have all decided it is in his best interest to go to a mental health facility and be cut off from this. I don't know what else I can say, but I am sorry. He was and is a kid, and is currently only 15. I don't know when you started posting or what he first saw of you, but for some reason, you became his fixation. He is going to be receiving help and counseling, and we are going to be spending thousands of dollars to figure this out. I refuse to let this happen to any other woman. I am sorry for doing this anonymously, but because my brother is a child, my parents have told me not to speak out about this with anyone else outside of family. I know that must be inherently frustrating for you, but it's important to me that you at least know that this problem was seen and will be taken care of. If there is anything else you want to know, please don't hesitate to ask. I only made this account to let you know what is going on, because I felt that it was close to criminal for you to not know about something that so dearly affects you. I know when I was being harassed online at the age of 13, my trust in people went down because I couldn't know who did it. I want to tell you it was my brother, a boy you don't know, who at a very young age found you online and became obsessed. There is no other way to say it. He became obsessed. I hope that eases your mind and your heart, and I hope you have a beautiful life again. If you need anything else, let me know. I said, would you be able to do me a favor? So I know this is all real. I need to see/talk to you on video chat, Snapchat, Instagram, Skype, it doesn't matter, because all this information seems suspicious to me. It's exactly what's happened to me to a T, obviously with a huge handful of things missing and some things that I didn't even know that they had on me. And I find it very strange that all this information would be in one place, especially some of the more personal things, like him getting me fired from my job. Unless he specifically wrote that down somewhere, which would also be strange, I just find it unusual. Also, this has been happening for 5 years. I just find all this hard to believe that a 10-year-old would do what, quote-unquote, he did back then. I find it all hard to believe, especially because I know it's you, Andrew, and I don't think you can fulfill my video chat request. And I've already decided I'm not going to take this anymore. I can't be held down by my past mistakes. I've worked hard to improve myself as a person and on my mental health. I needed to be a better person. I am a better person because of my mistakes. You can't hurt me anymore. Brita Filter says, if you don't believe me, that is okay, because of what has happened and the legality of it all. My parents are not comfortable with that, but I understand your issues. I hope you find peace, and I am glad you have moved beyond this. Personally, I am sorry that this has happened to you, and I wish you nothing but the greatest success. As for how we know he got you fired and information of the like, he has a video of you crying where you state someone got you fired and text documents of him taking credit for it. Though I doubt I will be able to convince you that this is legitimate, I do hope that you find peace with this, and I understand the trust is not here. If I could Skype with you without risk, I would, but according to my parents, that is a risk they don't want me taking. Meanwhile, I hope you know these were not your mistakes. These were my brother's, and he will be paying for them.
You didn't and do not deserve to pay for my brother's misgivings.
This will most likely be my last time using this account. I do appreciate your time, and I hope from the bottom of my heart and soul that you continue to do well. I pray you are able to forgive those in your life, and I know you will continue to thrive. Thank you for at least listening to what I've had to say and letting me know that words have gotten to you. God bless. What a ripe crock of shit. First of all, this is a pattern, right? Now that I've like gone back and actually like looked at some of the stuff people have compiled about Shannon, it's like this is certainly a pattern. She gets called out. And she goes, whoa, whoa, whoa. And she either adamantly denies the allegation or she does like this like softball apology. And then she's like, okay, I know you guys want more proof. And like, I'm totally going to get you guys that. But like, here's an obstacle as to why the proof either is vague or like, I can't disclose it. But then she kind of doubles back and she's like, but I do have legit proof, y'all. It's just going to like, there's like an obstacle in the way, but I have that legit proof. Just you wait and see, to kind of, you know, pacify the angry mob. And then enough of her fans pop up to like defend her that it kind of drowns out the angry mob. So like, just the casual passive viewer is like, oh, okay. So like, Creepshow Art's fine, right? She's not problematic, right? And then nothing ever comes of anything. There's no real accountability. There's no justice. There's nothing. And whether it be one of her actual Creepshow Art accounts or one of her sock puppet accounts, she repeats this behavior when she gets called out. She does this dance. Maybe she mixes up the steps a little bit. And then nothing changes. Also, wasn't it really interesting that this Britta person just so happened to also have been stalked and harassed when they were 13, just like Shannon has claimed? I think that's really interesting. And I know a few of you may be like, hey, this Britta filter thing is basically just Shannon like trying to quell the storm without, you know, causing a big fuss. She's just trying to let you know that it's like over and she's going to get her husband some help. That's not at all how I'm interpreting this. Like, now that I've seen all those lolcow posts and how she talks about other people and for how long she's been doing this, I am fully convinced that she has been on board this stalking and harassment train of me for so much longer than I had initially suspected. This Britta filter thing was Shannon trying to absolve herself of guilt while still holding something over my head. Like, hey, I'd really like for this to end, but if you ever come out with anything, here is a list of all the things that we have on you. Some things you didn't even know we had on you. Do you want a video of you high on heroin and drunk in a bathtub flopping around and reviewing anime, but fucking naked out into the public? We didn't think so. So let's all just forget about this. This never happened. Let's never talk about it again. What's funny, like I mentioned before, you can see I'm still not 100% convinced that Shannon was involved at the time I was responding to Britta Filter. I was totally convinced this was Andrew. After actually having the conversation with Shannon and seeing all her lolcow posts and seeing her patterns and her behaviors, I am convinced that yes, Andrew started all of this. He stoked the fire. He was the one, the man obsessed. But then he roped Shannon in, and boy, oh boy, did she become the ringleader ultra fast. Now, obviously, I face a moral dilemma here with the IP addresses. You can see that earlier on in the video, I did blur out some sensitive information, because regardless of how Shannon treated me, the information she gave me was sensitive at the time, may still be sensitive, and I told her that I wouldn't share it, and I'm not going to. And it's not really even that relevant. It was just her, I think, trying to get some sympathy from me, so it's not like that's relevant at all. I do realize that the IP addresses are relevant, however. I can't, in my right conscience, share those IP addresses. It's against my moral code, and my morals mean a lot to me. I just don't believe in doxing someone publicly like that. Now, obviously, if I had to get the police involved, that would be a different story. I can, however, give you some other pretty solid proof. So here is the blurred out screenshot of the information, the IP address and everything else. And if we go over here to get info, we can see that I took this screenshot on October 24th, 2018 at 7:31 p.m. We can also see that I took these Lily Singh screenshots on October 24th, 2018 at 4:34 p.m. and 4:35 p.m. And here we can obviously see that the video that Lily Singh was commenting on, My Problem with a Big YouTuber, was posted on October 24th, 2018. And as you can see here, 2 days later, on October 26, 2018, that is when Creepshow Art mentioned me in her Instagram story, and later that evening is when I decided to confront her with the proof. The other IP that I was referring to, the one where I was just like totally oblivious that it was Andrew, I was like, I don't know, it's such a big city, who could it be? I have this email draft from 2013 where it's basically me begging the staff at Facebook to try to help me gain access back to this account. I'm letting them know that I'm being harassed and this stalker had hacked into this account. I think they phished me. I think that's really what happened. I even say here that the police turned me away because he hadn't threatened my life yet. I even say down here at the bottom, I am on the verge of suicide because the harassment has become 24/7. Then I include back the IP and the information that the automated Facebook message had sent to me. What's even wilder that I didn't even notice until just now as I'm narrating over the screenshot is two emails above, we see an email that says Isla's Universe. And you know who slash what is Isla? That is Andrew's old band name. So we open this email and I say, so what I'm planning to do is digitally draw in a vision of never-ending space where he's looking out onto. I'm thinking of having a meteor shower on the top left outside of the door frame. Homage to your old band name, winky face. He's had many band names. And then maybe a small satellite? I'm not sure, but it's the idea of him taking the plunge from absolute nothingness, the white hallway he's standing in, to absolute nothingness. Complete voids, but whereas one is oppressing and colorless, the other half is celestial and constant. I don't know. What do you think? We can go over more after Tuesday. Let me know. Cute little heart at the end. This was 2 months after I almost wrote an email to Facebook staff saying I wanted to kill myself because the harassment was too much to bear and I really would like access to my old Facebook account, please. So if everything I just included was not enough proof for you, I don't know what to tell you, and I think you should move along. Now, I realize the number one thing that I can't prove here is how much involvement Shannon had in orchestrating the harassment. It is my personal belief that Shannon kind of had like this little sidekick role at the beginning. I feel like at the beginning it was kind of like an inside joke. I'm sure in Andrew's head it was more than an inside joke, but eventually Shannon just got too roped into it, and it became an obsession for both of them, and then it just kind of spiraled out of control. I think when we see it really spin out of control, not to like minimize like the torment I had gone beforehand, but I'm just talking on like a greater scale. I think we really saw it get out of control when Shannon entered the YouTube space and started gaining some popularity. I do think she saw the success of my sketchbook story times. I wasn't doing that many because my sketchbook story times are not fake. I don't have an unlimited amount of fucking stories. So she saw a market there and she just was making tons and tons of them, pumping them out. It got her channel really popular. So then she started doing drama and commentary. That also gained her a lot of views and subscribers. And I think just the power went to her head. And I think she believed that she would never get caught for harassing me for so long. So she decided to start exerting that control in other places. In just a few of the videos that I've watched of her, she has mentioned having strict parents multiple times. So I think probably growing up, she didn't have a lot of control. And this was one place that she could have just complete and utter control over something. Now, I'm not saying this makes any of what she has done okay. I'm just saying I was in a place very similar to her. I felt very out of control of my mind and my body, and a way to take it back was to kind of be a catty bitch. And even though my catty bitchiness was more on the level of delisted.com and less on the level of lolcow.com, I still had a lesson to learn, and I still had a lot to change about myself. And I will never stop reminding you guys of that. And even though it's sweet, I'm not a big fan of people being like, oh my gosh, you're so wholesome or non-problematic queen. I want to say no, your faves are problematic and so are you. And in a way, that's a good thing depending on how you handle it. When you are confronted with the fact that you are making a problematic decision or a statement, you need to face it. And you need to take accountability and you need to use that mistake to move on and do better. You cannot run from it because it will catch up to you, whether that be from public retribution or from your own stunted growth. It will catch up to you. Thank you guys so much for watching. I'm running on fucking empty. Don't forget to stay out of trouble. See you guys later.